Tonight's debate is moderated by three students from the center's leadership team and executive council. They are Olivia Johnson, Tom Cloward, and Jacob Gertler. Olivia is a senior majoring in nutrition. Tom, next to her, is a senior majoring in political science. And Jacob, who you'll meet later, is a junior majoring in political science and philosophy. And I now turn the time over to the moderators.
Hello. Can you hear me? Okay, great. All right, the format of these debates will be as follows. Each candidate will be allotted 1 minute for an opening and 1 minute for a closing statement. The moderators will ask a series of questions, and each candidate may take 1 minute to respond. We will notify the candidates when they have 15 seconds left to respond by holding up a yellow card. We will hold up a red card when time has expired. The order of opening and closing statements has been determined by a random generator. We will rotate candidates as to who will answer the first question, or the questions first. To conserve time and allow for more questions, we ask that you hold your applause until the end of the debate. We will now have the candidates for the Utah State Senate seat 28 join us on stage.
Okay, we're gonna get things started. Kick off with the opening statements. First, we will have Patrick Larson. Your time starts now.
Okay. Hello, everybody. My name is Patrick Larson, and the reason that I am here today is to run for Utah State Senate District 28. The reason that I am running is because over the last 2 years, I felt like our constitutional rights were stripped from us. We were asked to be muzzled. They muzzled our children. They told us there were things that we couldn't do. They called us terrorists and all kinds of things. We saw our constitutional rights basically being trampled under. In that process, there was a gentleman that went to the legislative session. His name is Mike Brown, and I actually have him out here with us here tonight. And he was arrested for simply being at a legislative session wearing a sticker that said, vote no or vote yes on HB 60, and a We the People t-shirt. And I thought that was an outrage. I couldn't take it anymore, and I decided at that point, after thinking about it for so long, that it was just time for me to get involved and to make sure that our freedoms would never be stomped again, and that I could help make sure that our freedoms would be preserved forever.
Thank you. Senator Vickers.
Thank you. I really appreciate it. Big thank you to SUU and the Leavitt Center, as always. You know, I'm a rural guy. I was born in Panguitch and raised in Beaver. Our family and I own many businesses here in Cedar City and Richfield. I love my family. My family means everything to me. And, you know, it's been a great fortune to serve in the Senate, and the last 4 years serve as the Senate Majority Leader. It means I've earned the respect of my colleagues and the influence there. But I think more importantly, it means that this district has had a strong voice in this legislative leadership. I'm a proud constitutional conservative Republican. I'm fiscally conservative. I believe in low taxes and limited government. That's why I sponsored SB 59 that passed last year, reduced taxes by almost $200 million. I believe in personal liberty and not government mandate. That's why I sponsored SB 195 and HB 1007. I believe in communicating with you. You've seen my articles in the paper. Hopefully you're getting my emails. In short, I think if you look at my stand, I think my beliefs and principles are probably a lot like yours. Thank you.
All right, thank you for those opening statements. We'll head into the first question. Mr. Vickers, if you'll answer first. Healthcare costs in Utah are high and disproportionately impact lower income families. Do you think the state's approach to healthcare is adequate?
So looking at what we've done in the state with healthcare, you talk about the low income, you're primarily talking about Medicaid, which is a federal program. We have expanded Medicaid. I'm not sure that was the best thing to do, but we have expanded Medicaid significantly. We continue to fund Medicaid. One thing that might scare you is always education has been the biggest portion of the state budget. This is the first year that Medicaid is the biggest portion of the state budget. Now, a lot of that is federal money coming through. We've tried to stay out of the way of the free market and allow the free market to work on commercial plans and other things. If you actually look, if you compare Utah to other states, we're looked at being very affordable and have a higher level of care, medical care. So do we need to do more? Yes. Are we doing a pretty good job? I think so. What kind of grade? I don't know. What do you say, B?
All right, Mr. Larson, your response.
Healthcare is a big issue, obviously. I know there was times where my family couldn't afford healthcare. I think we need to open up the markets more. We need to make sure that there's even smaller companies that can come in and offer the healthcare that we need. It seems like places like IHC have a kind of a monopoly on our hospital systems here. We need to open that up more. I believe that, I hate to always say anything about we need legislation, because I believe we need less and less legislation all the time, but we need to make sure that our markets are open and free, and that we give small businesses the opportunity to go out there and find that healthcare in whatever market that they can, so that they can afford it with their employees.
Thank you. Okay, for the next question, according to the 2020 census, Iron County's poverty rate stands at 13.7%. This is nearly double the overall state's poverty rate of 7.3%. What do you think is needed to lower the poverty rate in Iron County? And we're going to continue switching off, so Mr. Larson will be first.
That's a tough one. Again, I think we need to deregulate some of the more of the small businesses. You know, there's small businesses have so many regulations on them. I know as a person in construction, we have so many rules, so many regulations, so many things that we have to pay all the time. Some things like the DOT rules that we have of just having a small truck, and then you have to have a sticker on it, and you have to have the DOT registrations. We just need to take a lot more of these regulations that we have for small businesses and make them basically go away. The free market and the small businesses are the lifeblood of America and should be the lifeblood of Utah. And if we don't continue to encourage that, and we don't continue to lessen and lessen the legislation for the small businesses, they can't thrive. If they can't thrive, they can't hire people in, and they can't get the lower end employees and get them to come up and teach them and train them and bring them out of poverty and up into a way that they can make a living.
Thank you. Senator Vickers.
Thank you. So this is an item that really is big for Southern Utah, and it's been a big part of my role in the state Senate. So we're fortunate that we have a governor that has put his money where his mouth is. You know, he has a center here in a Southern Utah center here in Cedar City at SUU. Some of the things we've done, though, you talk about regulation. We actually passed legislation. It's called the Regulatory Sandbox Bill that actually is working on decreasing regulation in businesses. But it's all about economic development, but you got to have the right economic development to come into a community like Cedar or Panguitch or Beaver, places like that. So as we continue to move forward, we have put together programs. So at Rural Education TIF Fund. So that is a piece of legislation that actually specifically targets and allows incentives and promotions to go for businesses coming into rural Utah. One of the first ones that's just getting those grants is a business that's going in north of Beaver. So more to come.
All right, for question number three, the future availability of water in Southern Utah is of great concern in our area. Last year, this great hall was packed with several hundred concerned citizens attending a briefing from the Central Iron County Water Conservancy District. What are your short-term and long-term plans to address your critical need for water, our critical need for water? Senator Vickers.
Thank you. So water, as you can see in the drought we've got, I don't know what the deal is, but I talked to a friend of mine in Northern Utah today. They got a monsoon and we got the wind. So drought is going to continue to be an issue. Water, specifically, we put a lot of money into ag optimization, so allowing farmers and ranchers to be more efficient with the water they use. We passed bills that allow for water banking so that if they do reduce their consumption and still produce the same crop, they don't lose their water right. We're looking at money to put into storage and those types of things. Specifically, you know, you've got the pipeline that wants to come over from Beaver County. Unfortunately, that is a very toxic issue for me because I represent multiple counties, and I've got counties on both sides of that fighting. So I've had to kind of stay out of that one. I'll have to let the agencies and the courts decide that. But specifically, the state is moving forward with funding in specific areas to help and specific legislation to try to help preserve the water we have.
Thank you. Mr. Larson, your response?
I don't think my response could be too much different than Mr. Vickers' response on that. It is a big issue that we've all been working on. I know Paul Cousins is probably the biggest guy around for water. He has pretty much almost every answer that there might be, but I think it is a state's responsibility to make sure that the water rights are preserved, it's the city's responsibility to make sure that the water rights that they have are preserved and that they use those water rights. I think we need some more help with the aquifers. We need some more help with maybe even building some more retention. I don't know. That's another thing that everybody is actually looking into on how to get it better and better and better. As far as the pipeline coming over from Beaver, I do take a stance on that, and that is pretty much, I believe that's a decision that has been won in the courts or is being taken up in the courts, and it is everything there is legal, everything is pretty well done, and that's one of the things that's going to help out Iron County.
Okay, thank you. The Utah Department of Health states that drug poisoning is the leading cause of injury death in Utah. 10 adults die each week from drug overdose throughout the state, and 80% of those deaths are a result of prescription and illicit opioids. How can the legislature address this? Mr. Larson.
Well, that's another tough one. Prescription overdose, so I've had a lot of friends that have, I shouldn't say a lot, I've had a couple of friends that have died from prescription overdoses. Once they get hooked on it, it's hard to get off of it. The pain pills and so on. And I believe that, you know, a lot of that is going to have to be through education. Education is one of those things that we need to talk to our kids about. We need to talk to even adults about. There's plenty of rehab programs out there. A lot of those things are also personal choices. Some people made choices to get on things. Some people didn't. The doctors prescribed them. I don't have a problem with it. I don't understand it all the way. So I don't know exactly how to answer that question. I'll just be honest with you, because I just don't understand the mentality behind it.
Thank you. Senator Vickers.
Thank you. So the good news is, the bad news is it is high, but the good news is that rate is coming down. Some of the things we've done in the legislature, naloxone is a life-saving drug. We passed a number of pieces of legislation that makes it easier for people to have naloxone. For example, as a pharmacist, I can give out a naloxone prescription without having a prescription from a doctor. I can give it to a family member. I can get to a caregiver. And those are the type of things. Also, there's a huge opioid settlement. There's been lawsuits on the national level with distributors, McKesson, AmerisourceBergen, and Cardinal, as long with the pharma and Purdue Frederick and others. That money, I was part of the negotiating team this past session to put that in place, so the money coming back in, 50-50, about half of it will flow directly to the counties, half will flow to the state. It's about $18 million a year for over about 18 years. And then we'll use that money for prevention and treatment and those types of things that can really help. We always have good programs in place in a lot of places. Now this money will help to augment those.
Thank you. The Kem C. Gardner Policy Institute projects that from 2020 to 2030, there will be a 25% increase in the population of Iron County. Southern Utah University is the largest employer in Cedar City and expects to grow as well. How will you address the increased demand for infrastructure resources required by such growth? Senator Vickers.
Thank you. And a lot of the infrastructure pieces are done on a local level. So our job in the state level is to make sure that they have some resources. So if we have money available, if we have surpluses, we want to put money into those types of funds that can be used for infrastructure appropriately on a local level. Now, the big corridors, yeah, the state's going to take care of those. When you talk about transportation and some of those things, also we're putting a bunch of money into broadband this year. Pretty much every corner of the state's going to have broadband with the money we've put forward going on. So, but on the local level, when you start talking about sewer, water, and local roads, those are things that have to be done here. A lot of that's done through the gas tax, local taxes, and where we can, we will continue to put money into those kind of funds. That's our role as a state. It's not necessarily to go out and build a local road, but it's to help provide resources so that the local government, who does it best, can handle that.
Mr. Larson?
Again, I agree. There's, the local municipalities and stuff have the opportunity or have the responsibility to make sure of that. But I think the biggest thing behind that is they need to have a plan. I know Cedar City has a plan. I know Parowan somewhat has a plan. Paragona is putting together their plan. So the plans have to come from the cities. They need to plan for the growth. One of the things that I think was brought up to me earlier today was, you know, why are we continuing to grow so much when we don't have any water? I believe along with that plan is you need to have smart growth. You know, Paraguna for a long time had only two or three houses were able to be built. They since, because of the explosion in the population, they've decided to do away with that. And again, the problem is, where's the water? Parowan did the same thing. You know, now they've got a big old RV park and they're putting in 300 houses, but people can only water one day a week. So if you're going to plan, you need to plan and you need to cut it down, and you have to put a cahoodie on it basically and say only so many houses are available to be built.
Thank you. Affordable housing is scarce in Southern Utah. What are your immediate plans to increase the availability of affordable housing in Iron County? Mr. Larson first.
Again, I believe that's one of those local things that has to work with, again, state budgets or state planning. There are programs out there, USDA, RDA, and so on, that the locals can reach out to, and that citizens can reach out to as well, and get some better loans and some opportunities to get some grants for the upfront money to get into their houses. As far as being able to do any pricing or anything like that, again, that's on an individual basis, and that's something that we can't quite help with. I'm sure that Evan knows a little bit more about what programs are available through the state down to the counties and down to the municipalities to help along with that. I'm just at a little bit of a disadvantage on what is available.
Thank you. Senator Vickers.
Yeah, so housing is a real big issue. And a lot of people think that government shouldn't be involved in housing in any way, you know, just kind of get out of the road. And I think a lot of that's true. Those, as far as regulations and building codes, you know, those are set by standards. But so what some of the things we've looked at and the approaches we've taken, we have put some money, roughly about $36 million, I think, this past year into affordable housing. But what does that look like? Well, working that, there's some people out there and agencies that are working on this that have, they have a way of stretching money. So they can take a little bit, pattern it, you know, combine it with some other money and really stretch it and putting into some incentives and programs going forward. What does affordable housing look like? That's a good question. You know, is it just a square box out there, an apartment, so just somewhere where you can put your shingle and live? That's not really good quality affordable housing. I think there always has to be some design concepts, so, you know, so it's attractive. And also have some amenities, maybe a park and those kind of things. So as the local governments start to look at those kind of things, those are some things I would like to see them consider and utilizing some of the money we put forward.
Thank you. Historically, income tax revenue in Utah was dedicated exclusively to education via the Education Fund. Last session, the legislature changed the name of the Education Fund to the Income Tax Fund and expanded the definition to include entities outside of education also eligible for this money. Given the definition change, where do you see the future of higher education funding? Senator Vickers.
So is the question specifically about higher ed?
Yes.
Okay. So higher ed at one time was not funded through Education Fund or the Income Tax Fund. It was brought over. There was actually a constitutional amendment that brought it over. Now, the change that you mentioned is that was done by a constitutional amendment as well, allowing us to use certain things besides in the healthcare area for income tax. So it's trying to get a balance. I don't have time to explain the difference, but between general fund and income tax, but just know that there was a need to balance that out. Going forward, we will always commit to funding education, at least as long as I'm there. Most of the income tax will continue to go to education fund. We still use general fund in education as well. So between higher ed and public ed, it's a significant portion of the budget. Like I mentioned, it's now number two, but it is a significant amount. So I don't see that changing much. I really don't. Even if the constitutional amendment pushed forward to take that earmark away, we're the only state in the country that has it. But we'll continue to see a bigger portion of our budget going toward education.
Mr. Larson?
Okay. I believe that we're talking about higher education, talking about colleges and community colleges and so on and so forth. I believe higher education is a personal thing. To be honest with you, I don't know how much the state should be putting money into that. The state should be putting money into the K-12 program more than anything. Higher education, I didn't go to college. I know many people that didn't go to college, but they went to trade schools or they just went out and got a trade. I see a lot of people with with a diploma that aren't working, or with a diploma that can't work or can't get a job. So higher education should be a personal choice, should be a personal thing. And again, if you're going to put money towards higher education, it should be available for everybody in the higher education, so that everybody is on an equal playing field.
Thank you. Last year, Iron County experienced two of the largest floods on record. How will you ensure that we have proper resources to fight against floods, as well as potential wildfires and earthquakes? Mr. Larson.
Again, that's a question I think actually Evan's probably a little bit more qualified to answer for me. But as far as that goes, I believe the state has some funds available, and we just need to make sure that those funds, when the counties have an emergency and they declare that emergency, they can go to the state and they can get those funds and whatever it is that they need, so that they can take care of the people, take care of the roads, take care of the drainage, and take care of all the other things that come along with that. Same thing with fire and everything else. Again, that's something that we need to make sure of in the state, that we are always funded, that we always have enough for. And I don't know right off the top of my head which and how many of those different funds we have, but they know that they are available.
Thank you, Senator Vickers.
So on flooding, let me address that real quick. So what we have been doing and what we continue to should do is to make sure that there's money available and resources to come back to local communities to help augment their funding to put in storm drains and other things. And those low interest loans and those grant programs are in place, and they'll continue to be in place. Fire, wildland fire is a big issue. Every year we have the threats of wildland fire. This year I'm afraid it's going to be bad. I actually ran the legislation that helped set up the revolving fund that funds the wildland fire program. And so each year we have it up to a cap, and if we use it down, then we put more money in to bring it back up. That's legislation we ran a few years ago, is to set that up, along with working with the counties to provide, make sure that people that are at risk in areas, that they're doing appropriate thing to have defensible space. Those are things that we've done, and those things that we continue to do, and programs we set up. We've been fairly smart in some of those things. Flooding, the big thing there on the big funds, some of that's going to come from the federal government.
All right, thank you. We're going to move into the closing statement segment of this debate. First, we'll hear from Patrick Larson, and then from Senator Vickers will follow.
Okay. In closing, I'd just like to say this. I know that this is my first time running. A lot of people have asked me, well, it's your first time running. Have you ever held office? Have you ever done anything like this ever before? No, I haven't. But I also have a niece that hasn't, and her name is Lauren Boebert, and she's a great House of Representatives from Colorado. And she gives Nancy Pelosi heck every time. But she has come into her own, and she has become one of the greats. And she is one of those people that they look to find out what is free and how the Constitution is. And that's the type of person that I will be if I go up to the Utah State Senate. I am there for the freedom. I am there because we were muzzled, we were masked, and we were tortured for the last 2 years. And I just want to make sure that never, ever happens again. And we need to make sure that the governor's powers are taken away from him to do that, which they kind of did that. I think it was a little bit too late. But those are the things that I stand for. I will be a voice, and I will be a fight for the people. A fighter, excuse me.
All right, Senator Vickers.
Thank you again to SUU and the Leavitt Center for always providing a fair and balanced debate format. It's been an honor and privilege to serve you in the State Senate, and we've done some really good things together. We passed some good legislation. We provided needed funding that helps benefit our families and our loved ones. Utah just received the honor of being number one in rich states, poor states, for the best outlook for business economy in the state, in the United States. That's a really good story, but the problem is we've been first number one for 15 years in a row. So we've been doing some good things. Wall Street Journal just did a survey of all states. They rated us number one in how we handled the pandemic. Thank you, the voters, for allowing me to serve you. My parents taught me to do my best in everything I do, and I plan to do that in everything I do. They also taught me to listen. So my favorite habit from Steve Covey is to seek first to understand and then be understood. I've learned that I have to listen to all sides before I make decisions, and always go back to what is best for my constituents. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Let's give a round of applause for the State Senate, seat 28.